Just a few miles from Toadstool, archaeologists investigate a mysterious death.
We're not here trying to study an instant of what happened in the middle of the summer at 9,500 years ago and get a snapshot of that event. We're trying to understand kind of the whole motion picture that that one snapshot frame came out of.
It's supposed to cool off a little tomorrow.
This is the Hudson-Meng bison bone bed. It's the largest Paleo-Indian period bison bone bed in the Americas. And Paleo-Indian is the term we use for the early occupants of the continent, the people over here at the end of the ice ages.
These individual bones of the skull are fairly light and soft.
Dr. Larry Todd leads a team of archaeology students from Colorado State University.
You get back into here, into the pelvis, the hind leg, the femur, the tibia, down to the hind toes. So there you've got most of a bison carcass laying there with its head kind of pointing to the southeast.
An entire bison skeleton is by itself an impressive find, but the treasure at Hudson-Meng is the number of animals found.
There can be as many as 500 to 600 complete bison bones per meter square. And what it looks like that we have here is that this is the remnants of a large herd of animals that died as they were fairly closely packed together here. The bison that we're finding at this site are an ancestral form of bison to what we have roaming the plains today.
Exactly how the bison died is the great mystery. The site was first discovered in the 1950s.
The notion was that probably a group of Paleo-Indian hunters came across or were watching a herd of bison, and as they got close to the cliff, do something to frighten them and run them over the edge.
But was there a cliff here 10,000 years ago? Dr. Todd and his crew exposed the buried landscape.
What we've got here in this trench is we've been able to expose in cross-section here kind of a slice of what this part of the hill looked like. And what we can see is that right along here, you can kind of follow that difference between the darker sediments and the lighter sediments above it. And as we continue on up here like this, it begins to slope up, coming up there about like this, and then up into the next trench. It continues on about like this. There's the top of that same soil surface. On up to the next one here, and on up like that. And the initial model of what happened here at the site is that the bison had been run over the edge of the cliff, fallen to the base of it, and died as a result of the fall. Well, what we can see now is that paleosol that we just traced up comes up and it mantles the cliff, something like that.
When the animals died, there was a fairly gentle slope back there rather than a cliff.
Being able to expose this paleosol has, if anything, kind of added to our mystery of what went on here.
Z100.618.
You can think of analysis and excavation of a site like this as being a forensic exercise of what killed the bison and what was their last meal like, and you know, on and on and on, your standard detective story stuff.
For example, one mandible like this, we can have four or five different specialists study, and then when we get a group of them, we can start getting a good picture of the herd structure, the environment, the regional range conditions, the degree of tooth wear kind of tells you how much grit there is in the diet, which kind of tells you how much rainfall there was, and so there's a whole series of information that we can get out of there. The bison that we have kind of a whole cross-section of the population, from calves all the way up to real old animals. And the way disease, or many diseases, often operate is the younger animals or the older, weaker animals die first, and the prime age animals live a little longer. So this looks like these animals died fairly quickly, and unless it was an extremely virulent disease that would have knocked them out, you know, within hours of having contracted it all at once, regardless of age or sex or health status, disease seems sort of unlikely. So we've had to kind of reevaluate the whole notion of how the animals died, and I guess the best interpretation we have at present is that the cause of their death is clearly ambiguous, is the phrase I like to use. We're not sure. I kind of like the idea of a grass fire myself that would have swept across the area and sucked out the oxygen, asphyxiated the animals, having them die in place fairly rapidly. But that's a real tough one to evaluate. And that the birthing season, we can assume, was during the spring at that time as it is now, that this site, the animals died here during the summer. So it throws out all the possibilities of blizzards and, yeah.
The more the general public understands about what we're doing in places like Hudson-Meng, the more exciting the entire search for the American heritage will be. the story of the Americas is easily, easily as rich as anything anywhere else in the world.